Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we'll begin our inquiry into the impact of the pandemic on the Scottish labour market. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Dr. Hannah Randolph, the Economic and Policy Analyst for the Fraser of Allender Institute, Professor Steve Fothergill, Centre for Regional Economic and Social Research, Sheffield Hallam University, and National Director of Industrial Communities Alliance, who joins us in person. Welcome. Tony Wilson, Director of the Institute for Employment Studies. David Freeman, who's the Head of Labour Market and Households of the Office for National Statistics. And Louise Murphy, Economist for the Resolution Foundation. Thank you very much for giving us your time this morning and for all your written submissions. We estimate this session should run up to about 10:30 this morning, and each member should have approximately 14 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions, but just catch my eye if you want to come in at any time. For those witnesses who are attending remotely this morning, if you would like to respond to an issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we'll bring you in. I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak, and I must apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or the witnesses in the interests of brevity. Can I invite the witnesses to briefly introduce yourselves? Shall we start with Professor Steve Fothergill?
Yes, I'm Steve Fothergill from Sheffield Hallam University, and I've done a great deal of research over the years on issues around incapacity benefit and economic inactivity.
Thank you. And Dr. Hannah Randolph?
Hi, I'm Hannah Randolph. I am a research associate at the Fraser of Allender Institute for the University of Strathclyde, and I do research on the labour market and poverty.
Thank you. And Tony Wilson?
Hi there, I'm Tony Wilson. I'm the director at the Institute for Employment Studies, and we deliver research, analysis and consulting on things to do with the labour market, employment, education and skills, and have had a particular interest in the impacts of the pandemic on the labour market.
Thank you. And David Freeman?
Good morning. I'm David Freeman. I head up the Labour Market and Households team at the Office of National Statistics. And that team includes the people who produce the monthly labour market statistics for the UK, plus also the annual surveys around employment and earnings.
Thank you. And Louise Murphy, please.
My name is Louise Murphy. I'm an economist at the Resolution Foundation. We do research on the labour market and also wider research around living standards for people on low to middle incomes in the UK.
Thank you very much and welcome everybody. I'll now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. As I said, thank you for all your written submissions, and there's a lot of evidence for us to look through in these papers. I think one common theme throughout the submissions has been that the depth analysis of the impact of the pandemic on specifically the Scottish labour market has been difficult given the lack of Scottish-specific data available. Can I ask what you think the Scottish Government could do to improve the level of data available in the Scottish labour market specifically? Can I start with you, Professor Steve Fothergill?
Yes, okay, and good morning, colleagues. I think the data out there is a lot better than you're indicating.
Okay.
There are really two big sets of data which you can bring to bear on this issue. One is the labour force survey, which I think most of the researchers in this field tend to gravitate towards. And I know Tony from Institute for Employment Studies has used it extensively and continues to use it. Now that's based on a sample survey of households. And because of any sample survey, the smaller the geographical area that you want to look at, the iffier the data. Now, at the level of Scotland, it's pretty good. But, you know, for local areas within Scotland, it's it becomes more problematic. But that's only one set of data that you can look at. Now, in the context of long-term sickness, the other great set of data, which isn't mined so much, but which we use, is the benefit data set that is held by Department for Work and Pensions. It's on a website called StatExplore. And that's phenomenally good, actually, because it's based on administrative data. So you can actually count the number of people who are, you know, out of work on, say, you know, employment and support allowance or universal credit for whatever reason. You can count these numbers accurately, not only for Scotland, but also for individual local authorities within Scotland. And you can drill down and you know, look at issues of age, gender, et cetera, et cetera. So I think it's a much more mixed picture. There is actually pretty good data out there.
OK, thank you very much. Do you think there's anything that could be improved?
Short of a much larger sample size for the labour force survey, possibly not. No, I think you can actually get a good handle on these issues with what's out there. But it does require looking beyond just the labour force survey, I've got to say. I mean, one or two of the other witnesses may have slightly, subtly different views from mine, but the LFS is not the be-all and end-all of data on these issues.
OK, thank you. That's helpful. Can I bring in Tony, please?
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. David may want to say more about the labour force survey and also the transformation that the ONS are leading on labour market statistics, which I think will be hugely beneficial for understanding what's going on from the survey data. I'll just pick up Steve's point on the administrative data, a couple of quick points. One would be, one thing you could really do would be to press the Department for Work and Pensions to better disaggregate what's happening with universal credit data, and in particular, how that compares with the legacy benefits universal credit has replaced, and also what's happening with flows and duration. So I'll unpack that in just a sec. But on the legacy benefit, the benefits universal credit has replaced, the claimant count has been, and the measures of people on benefit has been significantly affected because there's been a transition of people from other benefits into universal credit, and it's hard to make comparisons over time. So I actually completely agree with what Steve said. I think we can make much more use, particularly for doing comparisons between places using administrative data, and Steve's done brilliant work on that. I think where it is a bit harder is understanding the pre and post, pre-pandemic and post, because it's so affected by this migration of universal credit. I don't think it's impossible, but I do think the department could do better on that. The second issue would be around HMRC pay-as-you-earn administrative data on employee numbers. And again, this is affected because there's been this quite significant shift from self-employment to employee jobs, which makes it hard to disaggregate what's the kind of underlying true picture, if you like, on employee employment. Again, though, it's really good. You know, I mean, it's big data that we could use a lot more. I think we could make better and more use of. And again, it's really supportive of making those comparisons between areas. I just have a kind of query, I suppose, about the extent to which you can how far it's a true measure given what's happened with self-employment. I just mentioned about flows and durations on universal credit as well. Here, the data is terrible. The department only measures the time somebody has been on universal credit in total. And during their time on universal credit, they may move in and out of work and in and out of different regimes, if you like. It'd be really good if the department could unpack more how long people are spending out of work, how many are flowing out of work and back into work, and how people move around between economic inactivity, so not looking for work, employment and unemployment. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. That's helpful. Can I bring David in, please?
Yeah, good morning. Thank you. And I'd just say thank you to two panel members for being able to say some really interesting issues around the data. Just to expand a bit on the LFS, probably just to point out that the Scottish Government do actually fund a boost to the LFS. So the sample size in Scotland is actually bigger than it would normally be if we just did the normal sample. So the data is probably slightly better quality than it would be for other areas of the UK. There is also what we call the annual population survey. So this is based on the LFS, which you do then add some more interviews to. The data isn't as timely because it's only for sort of averages over a year, but it does allow a little bit more granularity at the Scottish level. Picking up Tony's point on the pay-as-you-earn real-time data for HMRC, this is something we've been working with HMRC to expand what's available. So you can actually get data down to local authority level, and we've started doing cross tabulations by country and region of the UK. So you can get country by age and country by industry as well. You say what could be done to improve the quality. I mean, Tony alluded to the transformation we're doing of the labour force survey at the moment. We're doing two things there. It's moving to an online first version. So instead of doing face-to-face interviews, we go to people online to do an online survey. If they can't or aren't or don't want to do that. We then follow with a telephone survey, and we're just about to introduce a knock to nudge face-to-face element as well. The advantage of going to doing an online survey means we can have a much bigger initial sample. So the initial sample for the transformed LFS will be not quite double what the current LFS is, but pretty close, about 60 to 80% bigger. That will give us much more detail to produce more granular data for places like Scotland, regions of England, Wales, etc. And we're expecting to bring that in sometime towards the end of next year.
Okay, thank you very much, David. I'm going to move on to Murdo. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Camina. Good morning to the panel. I've got a couple of issues I'd like to try and pursue if time will permit this morning. First of all, I'm quite interested in trying to understand to what extent the issues we're seeing with in the labour market, particularly with economic activity, are Scotland specific or whether they're in line with what's happening elsewhere, either other parts of the UK or internationally, or whether there's any Scotland specific aspects we need to be interested in. Now, I appreciate everything you've just said about the data, so there might be gaps in the data, but I'm interested to get some views on this, and maybe I could start with Dr. Hannah Randall from the Fraser of Allender Institute to see if Hannah, you have any thoughts on this issue.
So one thing I would say is that we can see differences in trends and inactivity between Scotland and the UK as a whole. So we know that the UK had pretty steadily declining inactivity up until just prior to the pandemic, but Scotland, the decline ends earlier in 2015 or 2016, and inactivity started to rise after that. And so one thing that we can say from that is that there's likely something else going on in Scotland that's causing that inactivity other than the pandemic. And we know that during the pandemic itself, inactivity overall in Scotland didn't change quite as much as it did in the rest of the UK. And so there are some longer term trends at play, certainly. And maybe some of the other panel members can speak to some of those as well.
So I think we were just having a bit of difficulty there. I think there's a bit of interference with your microphone.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. Did you want to?
Yeah. Well, maybe we can move on. I could maybe ask David Freeman from the ONS the same question.
Yes. Hannah said, prior to the pandemic, you see slightly different trends in inactivity. Scotland historically has had slightly higher inactivity than the UK. And over the pandemic, while UK inactivity rose, Scottish inactivity was relatively stable, just above the UK level. What's perhaps quite interesting is comparing Scotland to the UK is what age group the inactivity is coming from. So at the start of the pandemic, a lot of young people moved into inactivity, probably people who perhaps were working alongside their studies who weren't able to do that during lockdown. And that happened both in Scotland and the UK as a whole. However, as we moved through towards the end of the pandemic, in Scotland, the number of inactive young people, 16 to 24s, actually fell and is now below where it was pre-pandemic. What's been similar in both Scotland and the UK is the increase in inactive 50-plus people, and those driving the rise in activity both in Scotland and the UK.
Thanks very much. And just to follow up, is it possible to draw any comparisons internationally, or do we not just have the data that allows us to do that?
We don't have as much data around inactivity. The UK, in terms of employment, is about middling in terms of the G7 countries. In terms of inactivity, we're probably slightly higher than some other countries, but we can write to the committee with some more detail later, doing those international comparisons.
Okay, thank you very much. I've got another question, but before I move on, do any other members of the panel want to contribute to that? Professor Flagel, yeah.
Could I make a very general point here, which I think is central to the argument, really, that I want to try and get across this morning? I can see that the focus of the committee is on, what has happened during the pandemic and immediately afterwards. But it is crucially important to remember that the phenomenon of high levels of economic inactivity and particularly very large numbers of people out of the labour market because of long-term sickness, mostly on benefits as well, that's not a new phenomenon. And what the pandemic has actually done is really only tweaked that phenomenon a little bit higher. You know, we have had in the UK as a whole something around about 2.5 million adults of working age out of the labour market on incapacity-related benefits since the beginning of this century. Now, it wasn't always at that level. I mean, if you go back further in time, you know, but at the end of the 1970s, you know, we only had about 750,000 out of the labour market on these benefits. But there was a major shift in the 80s and the 90s, and the numbers have really stayed very high since, fell away a little, not by very much, a few hundred thousand, and they've come back up a couple of hundred thousand or so during the pandemic. But to try to understand this phenomenon of why we've got people in Scotland or indeed in Britain, you know, out of the labour market on sickness and disability benefits, you've really got to take the long view and not just, you know, ask the question, well, what's happened during the pandemic to create this phenomenon? It's not a phenomenon of the pandemic. It's much, much longer established.
Okay, that's a very interesting reply because it leads me very neatly onto the second question I was going to ask, which is picking up what was in your written paper about the impacts of long-term sickness and in particular long COVID and what impact that's had on the labour market, because you suggest in your paper that you're quite sceptical as to the idea that long COVID is a major factor in an increase in economic inactivity.
Well, the big numbers in economic inactivity were there, you know, before the pandemic started. Yes, I mean, long COVID may contribute, you know, to the modest increases that we've seen during and after the pandemic. I mean, I think you would need to talk to one or two of the other witnesses, you know, on the specifics of long COVID. I don't pretend to be an expert on that. But actually, I also log that there's been evidence from the Institute for Fiscal Studies on long COVID, which suggests that those people who, you know, are suffering from it are not so much moving into economic inactivity, but they're actually still in work but gone on the sick for the moment. And so they would not be boosting the inactivity numbers, nor indeed the benefit numbers, not the benefit numbers for those, you know, on UC because of, you know, limitations on ability to work, etc. So I am sceptical. I think you have to look to much deeper rooted processes going on within the labour market, and also to take account of the fact that, you know, this phenomenon of large numbers of people out of the labour market on sickness and disability benefits is very geographically variable. It's not spread evenly everywhere. It's not spread evenly within Scotland. It's certain places, and in those places, you know, the numbers, the claimant rate can be 3-4 times the claimant rate that it is in the most prosperous parts of Britain.
OK, thank you very much. I'm going to go to David Freeman again, I think, because in your paper from the ONS, you do say that the data suggests some of the increased inactivity could be due to long COVID, which suggests you might take a slightly different view from Professor Fothergill.
I think it's a similar view that long COVID, it does appear to be contributing to that increase in long-term sick. But as the Professor said, that there already had been a large number of people who were inactive because of long-term sick prior to the pandemic. We've just seen a bit more of an increase during the pandemic period. If you look at, we did some investigations of the people who had long COVID and where they were in the labour market. And as a proportion of the people inactive, we found about 5% of people inactive had long COVID. But there were also a proportion of people who are unemployed, about 3.5% of those had long COVID, 3.3% of people who were employed, 2.9% of people who retired, and 1.7% of students. So that does seem to back up that while long COVID might be contributing to that increase in activity, there are people with long COVID who are doing other things in the labour market, as the Professor alluded to, still working, maybe on sick leave, or actually out there looking for work that will fit around their symptoms.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I just bring in Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you. Good morning, panel. Just on that thinking in terms of the impact of long COVID on the economics of the labour market, there will be. It's very difficult. Would you agree that it's very difficult for us to for the statistics to highlight those with long COVID who don't come into the office, who work part time from home, or so are still potentially partially active. I mean, the suggestion that there are 80,000 plus people with long COVID, and that certainly has a limitation. So how do you look at the statistics and plug that into to our thinking? I'll ask David Freeman again, since it was you that brought this up.
This will probably cover it. Again, we're probably slightly limited by the sample size. I mean, the way we find out about the people's employment prospects are through the labour force survey. That's by going to interview them, asking them a series of questions, one of which is whether they have limiting illnesses and whether that limits the work that they do. And then you can link that to whether they're working part-time, the industries they're in, the occupations they're in. However, as we sort of said in the answer to the first question, that will be limited by the number of people. If there's, as you said, there's a relatively small number of people compared to the total population, so we might not have enough to give us definitive answers around that.
Thank you. Can I bring in Louise Murphy, please?
Hi, yeah, just a few points following on from what's been said. I think I agree that we should see long COVID as part of the story, but definitely not all of it. And I think just one, I guess other reason to think of it that way is that when we look at the sort of the types of health problems that people give, we've got that in the data. We're not just seeing sort of a clustering of symptoms that relate to long COVID. We're also seeing increases in people noting cardiovascular problems and mental health problems, which again is a continuation of these longer term trends. And I think the other thing to say around health is that there's also some indication that now NHS waiting lists and waits for treatment are also having an impact. So there's been recent work by the ONS to survey people over 50 who have left the workforce, and when asked, just under a fifth, so 18% of those who are over 50 and have left the workforce have sort of stated that they are on an NHS waiting list waiting for treatment, which is higher than those who remain in work.
Okay, thanks very much. Tony Wilson, I think you wanted to come in.
Thank you. So, look, I very much agree with the comments made by Louise and David. I'll just add a couple of points. One is that there are different ways that this could be affecting the labour market. The first is, it may well be, I think Steve's point about people being in work and off sick, I think is probably an important driver of this. And this may well be somewhere which it might be worth considering whether people are more likely in the UK to drop out of the labour force entirely when they have a condition and may find it harder to get back into work than other countries. Because coming back to the point about international comparisons, one thing that is striking is the UK is one of the only developed economies in the entire world where employment is lower than it was before the pandemic. Like literally across the developed world, with the exception of I think the US, Latvia, Switzerland and Iceland, every other country has seen employment not just recover, but go higher than it was before the pandemic. So if long COVID is uniquely holding back, significantly holding back the labour force growth in the UK, you know, that isn't affecting other countries to the same extent. So part of that might be because of the nature of kind of employment protection and regulation and people dropping out of the labour force, finding it harder to get back. Part of it, I think, is actually likely as well, though, or perhaps more likely to be because of these other factors and other health conditions. So we've seen quite significant growth in people who've been out of work for a long time reporting long-term ill health, which I suspect means people who had health conditions haven't been able to get back to work to the extent that they would have done previously. And also we've seen significant growth in a number of people who've been out of work for relatively short periods, actually, and have health conditions too, which could be those people who left work, although that appears to be more likely to be amongst younger people perhaps than older people. There's quite a lot of things sort of going on here, I think, how health conditions could be affecting people's. So we've been very focused, I think, in throughout the pandemic around how health conditions may be leading to people leaving work. I think now is a good time to think as well about how a health condition may make it harder for people to return to work because of the lack of support, how we protect employment, and understandably as well, I think people's nervousness and concerns, if you've got a chronic condition, about coming back to work when there is still a pandemic and there's very little protective measures being taken in workplaces where people might be vulnerable to the virus.
Okay, thanks very much.
Alex Rowley, please.
Yeah, thank you. Could I begin with Dr. Randloff? In the paper for the Fraser Island Institute, you say, unsurprisingly, there has been sectorial differences in employment trends during the pandemic. So I suppose my question there would be, is there specific action that government should be looking at? Is there specific sectors that need more support in terms of recovery? What is that impact? And in terms of education and skills, is our economy, is our education system, our skills system geared up to be able to cope with the changes that are taking place?
So during the pandemic, we know that that certain sectors were more impacted, and we've seen a lot of that employment come back now in 2022. We have seen a shift that's part of a longer term shift away from skilled trades, services, elementary occupations, where the proportion of employment in those sectors has shrunk during the pandemic and still has not come back to the pre-pandemic level. But that's also part of a longer term trend, and it's possible that share will never fully return to what it was prior to the pandemic. And so those sectors may be areas in which upskilling or jobs training is needed for workers to transition into different sectors and different types of work. As for whether or not the current state of education and skills in Scotland is geared up to make that transition, I'm not sure that that's something that I could look into and get back to you in writing.
Okay, thank you. Could I come to that same question with Professor Fothergill? And the point you made, I mean, I remember I come from a mining community. My dad was a miner on strike 84, 85. And I was just saying to Jim, after the miners' strike, most of the miners that came out didn't then sign up for unemployment benefit. They went on to some kind of disability benefits, and the government seemed quite happy to keep the unemployment figures down. So I get that trend. But is our education and training systems geared to shift to whatever the new economy looks like? Or are we failing in those areas? Why is it that people with the lowest skills can't find employment?
Right, there were several things in what you've said there. Just on the issue of mining areas, I know the issues very well, and it was actually the riddle of what was happening in the mining areas that drew myself and colleagues into looking at the whole phenomenon of people dropping out of the labour market and going on disability and sickness benefits. I mean, I think it was invalidity benefit initially, then incapacity benefit and so on. I mean, there was a riddle there. You know, the pits had shut, yet unemployment was actually slightly lower than when the pits had been working. Now, you know, what had happened here? And it was a phenomenon of diverting people out of the labour market in difficult places where there weren't jobs to go to, diverting people out of the labour market onto sickness and disability benefits. Now, of course, the ex-miners and the ex-steel workers who were affected by this phenomenon in the 80s and the 90s particularly have largely dropped out of the figures now. But in the places where the balance in the labour market has not been fully restored, you know, it's been the people with health problems and disabilities in the generation beyond the miners and the steel workers and the heavy engineering workers and so on that have found themselves marginalised. You know, where there's competition for jobs, you know, employers go for the fit and healthy. You know, apart from going also for the better trained, they certainly go for the fit and healthy. And if you are getting on a bit in years and have health problems, you know, you're not going to find it easy to find work, even if you look hard. And, you know, after a period out of the labour market, you actually give up even trying and you resign yourself to a life, you know, of eking out the last few years until state pension age. You resign yourself to a life, you know, on sickness and disability benefits. That's been the big phenomenon that's happened in Britain. And it's happened much more so in some places than in others. It's happened in the mining communities of Fife. It's happened in the South Wales Valleys. It's happened in the Ayrshire coalfields. You know, it's happened in parts of Clydeside. You know, where the economy is prosperous, people can generally get back into work again. You know, maybe not exactly the sort of work that they'd like, but, you know, where the economy is very strong, people, you know, who drop out of the labour market get back into the labour market again, but not in the more difficult areas. And this is at the root of understanding why we went from 750,000, you know, on sickness and disability benefits of working age, you know, in the late 1970s, through to 2.5 million. You know, it's that mining phenomenon, a mining area phenomenon writ large across the country. I mean, look at the geography now in Scotland in terms of where the high numbers on sickness and disability benefits are. You know, it's the Inverclydes, it's the Western Bartonshires, the North Ayrshires, the difficult local economies. You know, Aberdeenshire's much, much lower. Not quite as low as in parts of southeast England, but much, much lower.
Yeah, OK. Could I ask, I mean, anybody else on the panel, in terms of looking at sectorial data, is there specific sectors that have been much more impacted by COVID and are struggling to recover? And are there steps that government should do across sectors or not? I don't know if anybody wants to come in on that. David Freeman?
I can give you a sort of idea which sectors are. I can't really comment on government policy. I'll leave that to the other panel members. If you look at, I mean, the areas that have been most affected are probably the ones that you might expect. So you can put, looking back to pre-COVID, within Scotland, the areas that have been biggest hit is arts, entertainment, recreation. The number of jobs in that sector is down over a quarter, down by 29,000 compared to at the end of 2019 at the moment. Other areas have seen large falls, the accommodation and food services, the hospitality, other service activities and agriculture, forestry and fishing have all seen relatively large falls in the jobs available. Been partially offset by increases in other industries, so human health and social work, as you might expect, has come up 33,000, and admin and support services, and also public administration and defence, so effectively central government has also increased. And these are also sort of areas that are also struggling to attract people. So if you're looking at number of vacancies, we haven't got vacancies by the sector for Scotland, but across the UK, health and social work is the biggest demand area, but that's always been quite high. Where we've seen increases are in wholesale and retail and accommodation and food. So these are areas where they've lost a lot of jobs. The demand is there to replace them, but the supply isn't coming through at the moment. And perhaps just say on a Scottish basis, we've got some experimental data where we look at online job adverts. And while for the UK as a whole, the ONS is showing that the number of vacancies has just started to fall from a record peak, the online vacancies in Scotland do seem to be at a steady level, if maybe even slightly trending upwards, so showing that perhaps the demand for Scotland is being maintained at quite a high level as opposed to the UK.
OK, Tony Wilson.
I was going to just make a similar kind of related point. The issue at the moment really is that we don't have enough workers to fill the jobs that are being created. So while there's definitely been significant challenges in some industries, and I think we intuitively we know which many of those are, and the data kind of backs this up. It's actually the growth in employment, particularly often in relatively higher skilled and professional jobs, that has been most dark for me anyway, that stood out most in what's happened on the demand side over the last couple of years. And again, that's where, again, internationally, I was on a panel for the House of Lords last week with Werner Eichhorst from an institute in Germany, and he was saying in Germany, for example, you know, the single biggest issue they've got is filling all of these jobs and how they're supporting those transitions to higher skilled work. Now, for us, you know, we, because we're so held back on labour supply, because we've got fewer people due to lower migration, due to people leaving due to ill health, you know, we're struggling to fill those jobs. So I think, yes, there are risks there are industries that have been significantly affected, but I do believe if we can work better on how we support reallocation and help people move jobs, you know, we can meet kind of growing demands and support a stronger economy in the future.
Tony, on that question, to what extent does pay, terms and conditions become a factor? For example, in social care, that's in Scotland we're really struggling, but you know, within the private provision, the terms, pay and conditions is so much poorer.
Yeah.
To what extent are those factors?
I think this is a really important point, actually, and it comes out a bit more broadly than the specific impacts of the pandemic. You know, when we're looking at what's happening on sort of labour demands, we're seeing really significant growth in nominal pay. So inflation is wrecking pay, full stop. But nominal pay in the private sector is growing really strongly, partly because there is such competition for jobs. But in the public sector and in you know, social care as well, which is kind of public and private, pay growth is really weak, like 2.5% year on year. And so partly what's driving really high vacancy demands in the public sector is that people are simply leaving. They're leaving jobs, and also people aren't taking up new jobs because the private sector is offering better terms. And that is a really kind of fundamental challenge, I think, that we're going to face in the next few years. Is, I mean, firstly, it's a cost of living impact on public sector workers, which are going to be at the moment phenomenally greater than they are on private sector workers because of this pay position. But secondly, is how vacancies are continuing to grow, actually, in many public sector industries, because pay is being held down.
Okay, thank you. And could I finally go to Louise Murphy and ask Louise, in terms of COVID and the impacts of COVID, are we seeing major increases in mental health? You talked about the waiting lists and the impact to that. I mean, is there data that we would be able to say there is a clear increase in mental health, there's a clear increase in people coming ill? Is that data available? What would your view be on the impact?
So we do have data around different health problems. As has been mentioned, we've both got the survey data, but we've also got really rich Department for Work and Pensions data that gives information about people on disability benefits, including those with mental health problems. I think due primarily to timing, it's hard to kind of draw a clear link and say how, you know, the direct impact of the pandemic. But I think what we can definitely see is, you know, since sort of the 2010s, there's been a gradual increase in the proportion of the population overall with mental health problems. And I guess just to point out, although in this inquiry, we're thinking about it in terms of those who have dropped out of the labour force and who are economically inactive, we are also seeing that among people who are in work as well. So we've seen quite a dramatic increase in the proportion of people who are in employment with mental health problems like depression or anxiety, and that's actually having quite a big impact on the sort of disability and employment rate. I think basically we can definitely see a trend in increasing mental health problems. And again, just to broaden out again, although a lot of the recent rhetoric's been around sort of older workers, we're also seeing an increase in economic inactivity due to mental health problems among younger people as well. So, for example, since 2006, we've seen the number of young men aged 18 to 24 who are inactive due to mental health problems double. And again, that predates COVID. So I think it's certainly a problem, but it's not all due to the pandemic.
OK, thank you.
Thank you. Jim Ferry, please.
Yeah, thanks, Camille. It's just a very quick supplementary to that. I think Hannah and Tony, you might be best placed to answer this. We've talked about, you know, employment churn, workforce churn, where people have stopped working for a period of time and then thought, actually, you know what, that lifestyle doesn't suit me anymore. And agriculture, hospitality, the care sector, all these. Hannah, you talked about people will be encouraged to re-enter the labour market if they see a healthy, buoyant jobs market. You could walk into any pub, club, care home anywhere in the country right now, and they'll offer you a job because they're crying out for people. So how do we square that up, that there's people who are desperate for workers, but there are people who are in the inactivity grouping that we're talking about in this inquiry? How do we square that up? Hannah, I'll go to you first.
So I'll take language from some of the publications that Scottish Government has put out in their employment policies, which is to say that we should focus on the right job at the right time for individuals. And so it's true that there are very high vacancies right now, and a demand for workers is very high. But if those are not the right jobs, then it's difficult to get people into work. And we know that there are priority groups in particular that face additional barriers to work, such as disabled people, single parents, and so on. And so these people will likely always need some additional support to enter the labor market. And so it's true that there are jobs out there, but it needs to be the right job at the right time.
Okay, Tony, do you want to add anything to that?
So was that to me? Sorry.
Yes, Tony. Yep.
Yeah. Well, look. I very much agree with that. I think what I would add is that there are issues around how effectively we're reaching people who are out of work. Certainly thinking about Job Centre Plus. You know, where do you go if you're out of work and you want to find help to work if you're not claiming the right bit of benefit? We don't really have a public employment service in that sense. So there are many people who are so-called economically inactive that say that they want to work. In fact, there's more people economically inactive who say they want to work than there are people unemployed, but they're generally not able to go into job centres to access employment support, and I don't think they're particularly a priority or able to access other sort of local support, including in Scotland. They're often sort of not able to. So how we can best reach people, I think, is the first point. So that we can help people find the jobs that they may want to do and understand what sorts of jobs are available. I think related to that, a lot of people have simply drifted into long-term economic inactivity following furlough, as you've said. And I think then it's very hard to get people back. You know, I think it was a mistake, looking back now, that we didn't provide more structured and active support to people who were long-term on furlough. And I think we are seeing really clearly in the data people moving through furlough and becoming longer and longer-term economically inactive, you know, in particular with the growth of people saying that they're retired. Which has primarily been a post-furlough phenomenon rather than an immediate sort of post-pandemic one. But the third aspect to it, I think, though, is also about what employers do. I think employers have been able to rely on kind of increasing labour supply for a number of factors, like a growing population, more older people working, more women in work, and higher migration. And that's been the case for 30 years. The labour force has grown. You know, changes in demand and higher demand have been met by higher supply for three decades. You know, it's been a consistent pattern. And that has gone into reverse in the pandemic. So employers do have to think differently around how you design, not just around how you recruit and where you advertise and the language you use, but how you design jobs, but how you do induction training, but how you understand your local labour markets. They have to talk more to local partners, to local employability partnerships, for example, and to Job Centre Plus, about how can we reach people and how can we work together. And I think we also have to think about how we support people better at work, you know, more flexibility at work in particular, and, you know, the particular issues that, that Hannah mentioned, you know, including in particular childcare, transport and health. So this is really difficult. This is going to be, I think, a permanent feature. Certainly it's going to be a feature for the next five or more years of a smaller labour force, high demand, and a need to think much more creatively about how we engage and bring people back into work who currently just don't go into job centres and tend not to engage with employment support.
Okay, that I have to say that slightly concerns me for areas of industry like hospitality and the care service, because creating flexibility in these kind of jobs is going to be particularly difficult, given the fact they actually have to be there. Louise, do you want to come in this point?
Yeah, I guess I agree absolutely with what Tony and Hannah says. I think just one supplementary point is when we're thinking about this group of economically inactive people who we're thinking about these questions of, you know, could they possibly fill vacancies? We do need to be clear in our heads that although there are some economically inactive people, as Tony said, who would like to work, but for whatever reason aren't looking for work, there is also a chunk of people who are inactive and do not want to work and probably will never work. And I think we shouldn't really be wasting our time thinking, you know, what more support can we give them, or what policies should focus on encouraging these people to work, when I think the reality is, especially, for example, older people. So if you're someone that's in your mid-60s, and the pandemic's happened, you were furloughed, you've now retired early. The majority of these people own their homes outright, are in a fairly all right financial situation. I think there's little to nothing that the government could do to encourage these people back to work. And that's not really where we should be focusing our energy. So I think we shouldn't lump together sort of economically inactive people overall. And we should think about those people who are economically inactive, who with some support could enter the workforce.
That's an interesting take. I'm going to regurgitate that one at a later date. Steve, do you want to come in on this as well?
Yeah, could I just come in very briefly, try to make four points in relation to what I've just said and the questions that have been asked. I mean, what one is actually, I don't think it's so much an issue that certain sectors have declined in the pandemic, but more, if you look at the figures, you'll see that it's self-employment above all that's not bounced back to pre-pandemic levels. I mean, the number of people actually in work as employees has got back to the sort of pre-pandemic levels, but not the number of self-employed, which last time I looked was a good 500,000 across Britain as a whole, lower than it was previously. Now, I don't understand what's going on there, I'll be honest, but that's what the statistics are saying. That's the first point. Second point on vacancies. We shouldn't think all vacancies are hard to fill vacancies, even though there are quite a lot of them out there. What a lot of the vacancy statistics tell us is the speed of turnover in the local labour market. Because if somebody moves from a job they've already got into another job, then their employer has to advertise to fill that job. And when they fill that job, if they're filling it with somebody else who is moving from an existing job, you're creating a vacancy chain. It's the turnover in the labour market. The labour market went into deep freeze during the depths of the lockdowns. And it came back to life with some vigour again. And as part of that phenomenon, there was a lot of turnover, which inevitably means a lot of advertised vacancies. Now, I'm not saying that there aren't hard to fill vacancies, but you have to be careful in interpreting the vacancy data.
Can I just say, before we go on to your third point, that's really important. That's a really important point, because then it's the sectors within the economy that need to do the work to reattract people to them. Because hospitality, you could fill your job pretty rapidly. Now you can't, because they've moved. They might not be out of the labour market, but that sector is suffering. Is that
fair? Well, I mean, the rate of turnover varies from sector to sector in normal times. I mean, there's always been a high rate of turnover of staff in the hospitality and catering industry. What I'm really saying is that when people start moving again from job to job, that in itself creates vacancies, even if the vacancies necessarily aren't inherently hard to fill vacancies. There are inherently hard to fill vacancies, I will accept that. And I think the health and social care sector in particular fits that particular model. But a lot of the time, it's people moving from job to job that in itself creates a vacancy. Yeah, they move, their employer has to recruit to fill the job. They fill the job with somebody else who's moved from another job. That job then has to be advertised. So that's partly what we're observing with the numbers of vacancies at any given point in time. Yeah. But there is an issue, and this is my third point, about the fit between, you know, what's out there in terms of jobs and what some of the people without jobs would like in terms of employment or indeed are capable of doing. And especially once we're on about people with some health problems or disabilities, and a quite large chunk of the workforce has health problems or disabilities, mental or physical, then that, you know, the mesh between what's there and what people can do is far from perfect. And the ones, and this is my fourth point, and the ones who really find it hard to fit back in again, after a point in time, they do give up looking. They despair. And I would wholeheartedly agree with Louise's comment that it's not everybody, you know, out of the labour market on incapacity benefits, sickness and disability benefits, on economic inactivity, if you like, that we should necessarily be pursuing. I mean, even our estimates, in the Sheffield Hallam team suggest that, probably no more than about 30% of all of those people who are on sickness and disability benefits would be in employment if we had a genuinely fully employed economy everywhere. The other 70% would be out of the labour market anyway. You can't get everybody back in again.
Right, OK. One very final small point, and Louise, it kind of comes back to yourself. You might want to jump in on this one. The loss of the over-50s and the inactivity, that to me feels like a huge amount of experience that the workforce is losing if these people have dropped out of the marketplace but aren't coming back in. And Louise, you're saying, let's not bother chasing them. I would counter that by saying that's decades of experience that we're losing to the workforce. So should we not be trying to get them back in the labour market? Louise, I'll start with you.
Sure. I think it's a totally valid point. I think maybe my, slightly more nuanced take would be, let's just look at that group age, 50 to 65, and acknowledge that there'll be huge variation within that. Maybe let's not focus on those age 64, but if you're someone that's age 50, maybe there's, and that person wants to work, then I think those are that's the group who's more likely to re-enter the labour force as time goes on. I think there's also, I think it's quite early to say, but there's, at least some idea that the cost of living crisis might have an impact. So there's been some recent survey data of people saying that, if their finances get worse, they would consider re-entering the labour force. Again, I think these things, there's a huge degree of uncertainty just on, how the next 12 months go. But that might have an impact. That, people who during a pandemic thought that they might be able to, for example, retire early, but actually they reassess their finances, that might not be an option. So there's definitely potential that some people might choose to re-enter work over the coming years.
Okay. You want to add to that, Steve, now?
I would just say that employers probably need to adjust their expectations a little. This is not just about, what does the individual want, but it's also what the employer expects of people. And I think for many years, employers in certain sectors have been able to recruit fit and healthy young workers. Often, I've got to say, migrant workers from Eastern Europe, Central and Eastern Europe. That may not always be possible in the future. And I think they need to recognise that there are people out there getting on a little bit in years, perhaps, who do have lots of skills that they can offer. But they maybe can't run around at high speed in warehouses like the 25-year-olds are able to do. So this is not just about, what people want to do. It's about what employers expect as well.
OK. Thank you.
Thank you. John Mason.
Thanks, convener. There's a lot in here to follow up on. Can I just go back to kind of the data and clarifying, and maybe this is for the ONS, Mr. Freeman. This term inactivity and economic inactivity, am I understanding it correctly that if somebody's economically active, they might only be working 1 hour a week or they might be working 35 hours a week? So they're all kind of lumped together. Is that correct?
The international definition of employment that we use is a minimum of 1 hour paid work in the reference week when we go out and interview them. However, very few people actually work a small number of hours. We don't actually count the number of people who work 1 hour. There isn't enough of them to give us a statistically sound estimate. But only around 5% of people work fewer than 6 hours a week or less. So most people are working more than 5 hours. The average is around just over 30 hours. That's about 36 hours for full-time and around 16 hours for part-time.
Okay, well, that's helpful. It just struck me that when we're looking at students, some students might only be working a very few hours a week and some are not, but some are being counted as inactive and some are counted as active. I mean, we had evidence from the, or a submission from the Institute for Fiscal Studies, and they were talking about the effective workforce, and I would take that as meaning, well, I'd be interested to hear what other people think that, but I mean, that's somebody who's really doing probably a full-time job. But the other angle on this is that some people have definitely reassessed their whole lifestyle and their work-life balance. And I mean, a lot of us would say, well, that's a good thing, spend a bit more time with your family and so on. I mean, I heard one guy on the radio, a musician last week, who said he never took breaks, and now he is taking breaks. So that's good in a sense, but it's probably contributing less to the economy. So I'm struggling a wee bit here to ask a specific question, but I'm just wondering, you know, is there an issue here that people are doing less hours, that they have got a better work-life balance, but that is actually damaging the economy? I'm not sure who I'm asking. Yes, on you go.
Maybe ask first. I think Tony wants to come in after me. There's no evidence that people work on average fewer hours. If you look at the total number of hours being worked across the UK, it's slightly below where we were pre-pandemic, but that's actually been caused because we've got slightly fewer people in employment. Average hours for part-timers is actually slightly above where we were pre-pandemic. For full-timers, it's very, very slightly below. So in terms of the number of hours each individual worker's doing, we're back to where we were. However, it's just that gap in employment that means we're not getting the total hours back to where we were pre-pandemic.
Okay, Mr. Wilson.
David's made my point for me. I mean, I would just say part-time employment, strangely, is lower than it was before the pandemic. This is partly explained by lower self-employment overall, but it's mainly explained by far fewer women working part-time as employees than they were before the pandemic. Part-time employment for men has increased a bit. Part-time employment for women fallen like hugely. It's fallen by about 500,000, which is kind of counterintuitive, really. But I think may reflect, I mean, it's speculation, but I think it may reflect people being able to work a bit more flexibly because of some of the changes we've had in the pandemic. It may also reflect some people in things like social care and health, which are sort of female-dominated industries, having to work longer hours during the pandemic and so on. But it is quite interesting. Yeah, the story on hours is much more sort of nuanced than it kind of feels like. Because I agree with you, you know, what we do here and what we have seen is people often shifting down and changing their jobs. I do worry though that that some of this may be storing up some issues because we are starting to see a rise in the number of people who are outside the labour force, economically inactive, and looking after family or home, looking after children. That's predominantly mothers of younger kids. And we're seeing the lone parent employment rate starting to fall for the first time really ever, the first time in about 30 years. And I do worry actually that things like access to childcare, lack of flexibility at work, and unwinding of some of the benefits of flexible and hybrid working that we saw during the pandemic may be starting to make it a bit harder now for people to keep coming back to work or to stay in work, in particular to stay in work if circumstances change. So I think we need to capture the benefits of some of the flexibility we've had, I personally don't view it as a kind of threat. I think it's an opportunity for us, I think, to think differently about how we can balance work and bring more work and life and bring more people into the labour force.
So, I mean, just to stick with you then, have we reached a settled state at the moment, or are we still? Well, that's a one-word answer, thanks. Because I'm thinking specifically like city centres and town centres. I mean, we don't really know if they're going to recover and eventually people will go back or whatever. But, do you want to expand on no?
Who knows? I mean, this really is sort of crystal ball gazing. It feels, you know, firms, we do quite a bit of work with employers and employer bodies as well as more kind of public policy facing research. And I think a lot of employers are really struggling with this. You know, what is the right balance? What's the balance between hard and fast policies versus, you know, using a set of principles? Should we encourage people back to work? And if so, how do we do that? What I would say is, I think there's going to be permanent changes in how we use city centres. I think we're simply not going to go back to full, you know, people working predominantly and full time in offices. And those will have really significant impacts on transport in particular and public transport. We're seeing this in every major city, but particularly in London. There's a lot of, you know, that tends to get a lot of kind of national coverage, certainly in England, about things like, you know, bus routes closing down in London aren't using them, and the massive funding problems Transport for London are facing. Now, those are important changes. I think we can't really hold back the tide on this, though. These are just adjustments we're going to have to deal with, you know, as we will have to deal with how office space and how other space is used in town centres. But I do think we're seeing an increase in office occupancy and people returning to work, you know, and spending less time working from home. But I just don't know where that will settle. I really don't, because I think firms are still struggling with getting that balance right. And I think actually many may well struggle to recruit in the tight labour market if their competitors are offering more flexibility, particularly in kind of professional knowledge economy jobs, which don't as much require physical attendance in the office.
OK, that's helpful. I'm not sure if anyone else wants to come in at this stage, but can I link to that, Professor Fothergill, if I may? You were suggesting, I'm interested kind of where we're going forward, that in your paper you suggest that, you know, in some areas there's no point kind of investing or boosting the economy anymore because they're at full employment already, and we should be targeting more our support at areas where there isn't full employment and which are presumably the needier areas.
I think that's correct. I don't see how you can raise the employment rate much further in substantial, prosperous parts of southern England, for example. There are probably one or two areas even within Scotland that fit that model. So if you're really, really trying to raise the overall employment rate, I think you've got to, you know, focus on the places where the employment rate remains low and where economic inactivity remains high and where large numbers of people are out of the labour market on sickness and disability benefits, and some of them might be brought back in. You know, so the key actually to raising employment is, dare I say, levelling up policy. I mean, levelling up is the term that the present government in Westminster uses, of course, but I mean, it's been around for donkey's years as urban and regional economic development, you know, trying to bring the less prosperous places up to the standards of prosperity of the more prosperous parts of the country. Yeah, I don't see that you can go much further in large parts of southern England in particular, and possibly, dare I say it, even in the Edinburgh economy, which always looks rather like southern England in terms of many of its economic indicators.
So, obviously, you're involved in the cross-party group on industrial communities, so your suggestion would be that if the Scottish Government has money, we should be focusing on the needier areas, the old industrial areas?
Yes, I think that's probably correct. I mean, I wouldn't say it's exclusively older industrial areas. I mean, it is the predominant largest single group of areas with difficulties across Britain and probably also in Scotland. But, you know, it's the places with the weaker local economies. These are the ones that have labour market slack within them still. Even after all the years of trying to rebuild their economies, we've made progress, but there's still, you know, a long way to go in these places. And if you can't raise the number of jobs where there's full employment, you know, you've got to raise the number of jobs in other areas. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, thanks. Another area I just wanted to touch on was long COVID, because we're going to be doing a separate investigation on that, so we're not going into huge depth on that just now. But there was a suggestion from one of the trade unions that some people are afraid of disclosing long COVID to their employers. And there was a suggestion somewhere else that perhaps some employers are more sympathetic to staff who might have long COVID than others. Can anyone comment on that or have any experience of that? I don't know, Louise Murphy, is that something you could have any thoughts on?
I guess not something that we've done detailed work on. But I mean, I guess I think when you look at long COVID, I guess because it's a new phenomenon, you know, by nature, we didn't know about COVID 2-3 years ago. I think it's natural that there'll be a period of adjustment just for employers to think about how they respond to it, for people with long COVID to think about how to speak about it. So I think some of this is, I guess, to be expected, and I think we should just see it as an adjustment period. I mean, for example, I know at the moment long COVID isn't classed as a disability, but there's some, or I guess there's some debate about whether over time it will be seen as or being classed as a disability under the Equalities Act. So, for example, that might be a reason why it will be treated slightly differently by an employer, because it's not, yeah, officially a disability like some other health conditions might be. Okay. But yeah, others might have more detailed answers than I do.
or I'll just go for Hannah Randolph. Do you have any thoughts on that kind of area?
So I don't have specific knowledge of what people's experience has been deciding whether or not to report long COVID to their employers. But I think Professor Fothergill emphasized earlier that in areas where you have some workers who are healthy and some that have poorer health, the ones that are healthier are going to have an easier time finding jobs. So I can certainly see why people would be concerned about disclosing long COVID, particularly if it's not protected as a disability. And so I think that that is something that warrants further attention from the government and further monitoring, although it is difficult because long COVID is somewhat difficult to identify. Right now we're relying on people to self-report, which is likely going to undermeasure, but the alternatives are also likely to undermeasure the extent of long COVID, just because it's not well understood medically right now.
Okay, thank you. If I could touch on another area and go back perhaps to Mr. Freeman from ONS. You mentioned ethnic minorities in your report towards the end. Can you say anything about the impact on ethnic minorities and how they are coping? I can't give you a page. It's the second last page in mine. Yes.
Yeah, I was just reminding myself. So I think the ethnic minority, it probably looks at a slightly more positive picture that economic activity has decreased for ethnic minorities in Scotland since pre-pandemic. So that's sort of bucking the trend of the overall picture. And the lower economic inactivity rates for the people than the UK average as a whole. So it does look like there hasn't been a specific impact on that particular group as part of the COVID pandemic. I mean, we talked about immigration. That's probably where we've seen perhaps the changes over the pandemic period, depending on where people come from. But in terms of ethnic groups, it doesn't look like there's been any adverse effect or more adverse effect than other groups.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you. That's me.
Can just move on to Brian Mitchell, please.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's very interesting listening to the conversation this morning. It's making my questions more complicated as we go along. I wanted to touch on the impact on early retirement. Really, Tony Wilson, you brought up furlough as almost a driver of early retirement. And I wondered, there are certainly industries with a higher age demographic. For instance, as a friend of mine owns a haulage company where many of the employees, are 50 plus, or, as Professor Fothergill said, are from Eastern Europe, especially from Poland, strangely enough. And during furlough, of course, a lot of those Eastern Europeans went home and then didn't come back because there's a shortage of drivers in Eastern Europe, so they have to pay more. A lot of the drivers over 50 decided that during furlough their work-life balance was better, so they didn't come back or only come back for a couple of shifts a week, which then means that the wages have exponentially grown within that industry. So I wonder if you know, I'm going to start with you, Tony, since you raised it. Have you done any work around industry-specific around early retirement that has had a significant impact on those industries?
I'm afraid that on this specific point about industries, we haven't done any analysis on that, particularly related to early retirement. I would say though, there is something interesting. The ONS did have done some really good analysis looking at published back in March and then in September, looking at for example, older people who've left the labour market by their sort of previous earnings, for example, and occupations. And I think, I mean, just to sort of paraphrase that, I think what that shows, which I think is quite interesting, is that people have left from relatively high paid as well as relatively low paid jobs, from high skilled as well as relatively low skilled jobs. But it does appear to be some differences between men and women, for example. You know, it does look like there's been quite a few that people who've been leaving relatively high paid jobs have tended to be men in more senior roles, as one might expect. And I suspect you even see this actually in the headline data. When you look at changes in employment by occupation, the number of people in the highest occupational group, which tends to be chief executives and company owners and directors, that's actually overall the number of people in those sorts of jobs has fallen since the pandemic and on the annual population survey, which I think may well reflect older men in particular selling businesses, taking the self-employed income support money, self-employed people generally leaving the labour force, as Steve said. But when you look at people who've left from sort of lower paid and lower skilled jobs, it's men and women. And to give an example of that, we've seen really significant falls in the number of people working in cleaning, for example, in domestic cleaning. We've seen rises in industrial cleaning, as you'd expect, but falls in domestic cleaning. That's predominantly a female workforce, and it's predominantly older people too. So there are definitely quite important differences. There are people who've retired on relatively, I think, decent pensions. We may not be as much as they might not last as long as they might have hoped it would, given what's happening now with inflation. But then there's a lot of people who would have left into far lower incomes and left from lower skilled jobs, I think, will struggle to come back.
I wonder if I could ask Louise Murphy if they've done any work around this area.
So I guess likewise, we've not done detailed work looking at differences in activity rates by previous industry or occupation. I agree with everything that Tony said to think, for example, about differences by sort of pay and gender. I guess just one point to follow up with is, I think this idea of COVID making people reassess their work-life balance, as you might put it, is important. And I think one reason to think of it that way is just when we compare trends in economic inactivity over the recent years since the COVID pandemic to those in the financial crisis or the aftermath of the financial crisis, they look very different. So, for example, after the financial crisis, after 2008, we saw an increase in participation among older workers aged 55 and above, whereas now we're seeing the opposite. I think that, again, just as another reason to think that there's been something unique about COVID, be it furlough, be it people being able to save more during the pandemic and choose to leave the workforce.
Okay, I don't know if anybody else would like to come in there, Professor.
Could I just say briefly that I think deep in the papers that circulated to this meeting, there's a summary of the views that on this issue that were put forward by Age Scotland, who make 6 points in terms of why people may be dropping out into early retirement. And without having done any detailed research on that issue, I've got to say those 6 points that Age Scotland make seem eminently sensible and a very, very good assessment of what's likely to be going on there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
So I'd recommend that.
And one other point that I would say, or one other area that I'm interested in, is just so taking that further, the attitudes to work and that work-life balance and the changing working patterns, hybrid working, the impact that's having on city centre workforce obviously is being significant. I think we've sort of touched on this before. So are we saying here that we are going to have to redesign what city centres are like, because, if we look at this meeting, four are hybrid and there's one person in the room. So normally speaking, when you have a business meeting, you're in a coffee shop somewhere, or you're having a lunch or whatever, and that's not happening as much anymore. So we're going to have to rethink the way in which we employ people within the city centre. And I'll go to Dr. Randolph, if I could, first.
So I don't have any particularly detailed thoughts on this, except to say that, yes, probably as the pattern of work changes, then we'll have to rethink a little bit how cities are organized. As someone's already mentioned, rethinking the transport system and making sure that that's set up in a way that works for the way that people are currently working and living their lives. Those sorts of systems will need to be need to pay attention to them as time goes on and adjust them as needed to respond to what's happening in the labour market and in society more generally.
I think with that question in mind, I was going to go to David Freeman and add in the potential here of having, you know, significant city centre offices lying empty. I think in my head I'm thinking we're going to end up people moving back into city centres to live rather than to work. I don't know if you've got any thoughts on that.
Probably a couple of things to think about. You talked about the change in working patterns. I mean, the pattern of home working has changed quite drastically since the start of the pandemic. Particularly in Scotland, it was around 15% of people were doing some sort of home working prior to the pandemic. That's just over 40% now. So a lot more people spending at least some of their time away from office space, working at home, working remotely. And perhaps going back to the discussion we were having earlier around what would tempt the older workers, the 50 pluses, back into the workforce, we've done a couple of surveys of that particular age group. And by far the biggest thing they will be looking for will be flexible working. So, you know, flexible hours around their lifestyle. And the third biggest reason would be home working. So it does appear to be that firstly, the people in work, their attitudes are changing in terms of where they work. But if you're trying to get this group of the 50 pluses back into the workforce, what will tempt them back in is flexible working, but also having that home working option. So it looks like there might be a longer term trend away from office working.
I don't know if there's anybody else who wants to come in, because that's my last question, convener.
Okay. Is there anyone else want to come in? Okay, thank you. Is there any members, witnesses would like to make any final comments? Okay, that's great. Thank you very much. Murdo, did you?
Professor Folliger opened his mouth there. I thought he was going to say something.
Yeah, if you're at the stage of final comments.
Could I just say, three things that you need to keep in mind all the time in looking at these issues. One is take the long view. Second one is do not ignore the geography of what we're looking at. And thirdly, don't forget the demand side in the labour market. This is not all just about labour supply. It's about what employers want and are willing to take and how many jobs there are out there as well. That's all. Just the 3 points. Long view, geography, demand.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you to all the witnesses today. It's been very informative and a really engaging start to the beginning of this inquiry. I'd like to thank you all for your evidence and giving us your time this morning. We intend to continue taking evidence in November before we hear from the Deputy First Minister at our meeting on the 8th of December. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you on how to do that. The committee's next meeting will be on the 10th of November, when we will continue our inquiry by looking at the drivers behind long-term illness into greater depth. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave for the meeting to move into private. Thank you.